This morning we're going to take a look at Psalm 71. So please turn there in your Bibles. You'll notice that there is no superscription in Psalm 71 as there are in many other psalms, which makes it a little more difficult to determine who wrote it and when and why. It's possible that David wrote this psalm, and people believe that because there's much in Psalm 71 that's echoed in other psalms that David wrote. For example, the first three verses here in Psalm 71 are almost identical to Psalm 31, the first three in Psalm 31. Verses 9 through 12 here are also very similar to Psalm 38, verses 21 to 22. And there are many other verses and phrases that can be strongly linked to other psalms that David wrote. So that's one reason people think David wrote this psalm. Some scholars also think that Psalm 71 is actually a continuation of Psalm 70. They're actually the same psalm, and David wrote Psalm 70. So another reason why some think that David wrote it. But no one can be certain. No one can be sure who wrote it. What is certain, though, is that it was written by someone who was elderly, someone who was aged, someone who was getting on a bit, someone who was well-seasoned, let's say. And that author had seen and experienced and rejoiced in God's ongoing faithfulness over and over and over again as he journeyed through life. That's for certain. Now, isn't that something that we'd all want to claim in the latter part of our life, right throughout our life, as we're nearing the end? That we've seen and that we've experienced and that we've rejoiced in God's ongoing faithfulness over and over and over again right throughout our lives. I'm sure we'd all want to claim that. Well, Psalm 71, it really serves as a picture of how we ought to be after a lifetime of walking with God. It's a portrait, let's call it, a portrait of a mature believer who's trusted and hoped in God despite what circumstances he was experiencing. And if that's what you desire in your life, well then let's jump in and take a look at this picture of this guy and see what we can learn from him. Now we're going to go through the psalm bit by bit, and I'll stop here and there and make a few comments and a few points. Psalm 71. We'll read verses 1 to 4 first. In you, O Lord, I have taken refuge. Let me never be ashamed. In your righteousness, deliver me and rescue me. Incline your ear to me and save me. Be to me a rock of habitation to which I may continually come. You have given commandment to save me, for you are my rock and my fortress. Rescue me, O my God, out of the hand of the wicked, out of the grasp of the wrongdoer and ruthless man. Now, the first feature of the seasoned saint that I want to highlight here is that a mature believer knows God and goes to God. You know, straight off the bat, the first thing he says in verse 1, he's just declaring that his hope lies in Jehovah. His hope lies in the Lord. He takes refuge in his God. He knows God provides him that refuge. And so he goes to him for safety, for shelter, and for security. And he asks that he never be put to shame as a result. That his trust in God as his refuge will never backfire on him. And he shelters comfortably in that knowledge that God is in control, that God can save him from the situation that he's in. He knows God and he has confidence in him because he knows God's character, that God is righteous, he says in verse 2. Verse 2, he asks God to incline his ear and praise, in your righteousness, deliver me and rescue me. Note that he doesn't say, in your mercy, deliver me and rescue me. In your grace and love, deliver me and rescue me. No, he says, God, in your righteousness. And it's upon this attribute of God, it's upon this that the psalmist pleads, in God's righteousness. You know, because God is righteous, we can trust him. We can trust him to always do what is right, always do what is good, what is proper, especially when life's tough and it isn't going our way. We can be sure that God's not up there taking us through these tough times just for jokes and giggles. You know, that's not God. That's not God's character. That's not who God is. He knows what we're going through and he cares. And for whatever reason he's taking us through a difficult time, we can know his purposes are good and right because he is righteous. The veteran of faith knows God's character and God's capabilities. He knows God's capabilities. God is capable to deliver and to rescue. And that's why he goes to him. He can deliver us out of the hand of the wicked. He can rescue us out of the grasp of the wrongdoer and ruthless man. Now, we're not sure exactly what situation this guy was going through at the time, but it seems that there are a few guys that were out to get him, out to cause no little disruption to his life. He was obviously quite aware about it, quite concerned about it, but he knew that God was capable of delivering him and rescuing him, and he's capable of doing that for us today as well. Ephesians 3:20 tells us God is capable of doing far more abundantly than our finite minds can possibly ask or even imagine. So we too need to know God and go to God because he is capable. The aged follower of God also knew God is capable of being a continual rock of refuge, a safe haven for the soul, a place of sanctuary. That's what he had in God. He knew that. He knows, and so he goes to God seeking the security and the comfort that is only found in him. And so I have to ask, do you all know God as a rock of habitation to whom you can continually come? No matter what time, no matter what type of situation you're in, you know that God is your safe place, that God is your refuge. Do you know God that way? God is a rock of habitation to whom we can continually dwell in for comfort and for shelter. So this guy knows God's character. He knows God's capabilities. He knows that God's capable to deliver and rescue from the overwhelming circumstances of life. He knows that God is capable of being a strong and mighty rock and fortress, a place of refuge and sanctuary to those who go to him. And we can see there in verse 3, he also knows God's commandment. It says in verse 3, you have given commandment to save me. Now it seems that he believed that God had decreed or ordained that he be saved from the mess that he is in. Perhaps this is based on the promises that God gave to all the people of Israel. Promises like what's found in Deuteronomy chapter 28 verse 7, where it says, the Lord shall cause your enemies who rise up against you to be defeated before you. They will come out against you one way and will flee before you seven ways. Now that'd be a great promise to cling to and hold on to, wouldn't it? If indeed this author of chapter 71 here is David, then listen to what Ethan the Israelite, writes about him in Psalms 89, verses 19 to 26. Of old you spoke in a vision to your godly one and said, I have granted help to one who is mighty. I have exalted one chosen from the people. I have found David, my servant. With my holy oil I have anointed him so that my hand shall be established with him. My arm also shall strengthen him. The enemy shall not outwit him. The wicked shall not humble him. I will crush his foes before him and strike down those who hate him. My faithfulness and my steadfast love shall be with him, and my name shall be his horn, and in my name, his horn shall be exalted. I will set his hand on the sea and his right hand on the rivers. He shall cry to me, you are my Father, my God, and the rock of my salvation. Was this the promise? Was this the commandment that the writer was clinging to, that the writer was claiming before God at this time? What's certain is that this aged believer knew God's commandment and he knew his God. He knew God in his righteousness would act in according to what he had said. He knows God and he goes to God in prayer. This whole psalm, as you read through it, you can tell it's a prayer to God. A prayer in which the author goes to God, expresses his trust in him, recounts God's faithfulness, and asks God to help in this situation. And again, I have to ask, is this same God your port of call, your safe haven, your place of security when the seas of life get rough? Do you know this God? Is he your rock of refuge and shelter when the storms of rage throw your life into disarray? According to his character, according to his capabilities, and according to his commandment, he's willing and able to be that for you if you would but go to him. An advanced believer, one who has well trodden the path of life with their Lord, trusts God in whatever circumstance they find themselves in, because of their knowledge of God's character, of God's capabilities, and of God's commandments, the promises given by righteous God in his word. And then as we read on, we see that this knowledge of God is reinforced and fortified with personal experience. We'll carry on reading Psalm 71, verse 5 through to 13. For you are my hope, O Lord God. You are my confidence from my youth. By you I've been sustained from my birth. You are he who took me from my mother's womb. My praise is continually of you. I've become a marvel to many, for you are my strong refuge. My mouth is filled with your praise and with your glory all day long. Do not cast me off in time of old age. Do not forsake me when my strength fails. For my enemies have spoken against me, and those who watch for my life have consulted together, saying, God has forsaken him. Pursue him and seize him, for there is no one to deliver. O God, do not be far from me. O my God, hasten to my help. Let those who are my adversaries of my soul be ashamed and consumed. Let them be covered with reproach and dishonor who seek to injure me. We see here, my next point, is that the mature believer trusts in God and remembers his faithfulness. He declares in verse 5, you are my hope, O Lord God. You are my confidence from my youth. He trusts in his God. His trust, his hope, and his confidence is in the one that has sustained him right throughout his long life. Even before birth, God had faithfully sustained him. I like the way the ESV translates verse 6 there. It says, upon you I have leaned from before my birth. He acknowledges that even before his birth, he was propped up and he was sustained by God. Even before he was born, God is ultimately the one who takes us from our mother's womb and brings us into this world. And the mature saint remembers this and acknowledges this and praises God continually for that. And there's an application there for us. You know, no matter how tough life gets, we should always thank and praise God for giving us life. Life is a gift from God. And he deserves the thank and praise for giving it to us. You know, if only we'd remember that and act on it before we started our complaining, it'd be a great thing. The author remembers God's faithfulness throughout his life and praises God for it, to the point of marvel we see in verse 7. Now, why did the many people marvel? Or perhaps they marveled at the fact that this guy still had faith. That life for him, as it is for all of us, is never plain sailing. It's a bumpy ride. There's plenty of ups and downs as we go through life. But despite this, this aged believer was still going strong in his faith for God. God was still with him. He was still his strong refuge. And how did the many people know this? Well, no doubt it was because this guy told them about it. In verse 8, he says, "My mouth is filled with your praise and with your glory all day long." Now, there's a verse that we need to apply all day long, isn't it? At least for the rest of our days, however long they may be. My mouth is filled with your praise and with your glory all day long. Let's try applying that throughout 2021. The author continuously remembers God's faithfulness throughout his life and praises him for it. That's very evident throughout the whole chapter. And yet the psalmist, he finds himself in a tough situation here. His enemies have spoken against him, he says. They have observed the trials that he's been going through. They observed his life, and they concluded together that God's forsaken him. God's left him. He's on his own. God has finally turned his back on him. So they decide, right, now's the time. Now's the time to pounce. Let's chase him down. Let's seize him. Let's hurt him, because there's no one there to save him. And so, as we've read, he pleads with God to continue being as faithful in his old age as he has right throughout his whole life. He calls to God to come quickly and help and prove his enemies wrong. He asks that the adversaries of his soul, those who are seeking to injure him, that they be ashamed, that they be consumed and covered with reproach and dishonor. That God would once again illustrate his faithfulness, just as he had done throughout his whole life, and save him. Thus, humiliating those who had said, you know, God's forsaken him, he's gone, he's given up on this guy. And proving that he was as near as he had always been, there, ready and willing to protect his own. You know, in doing so, he'd again be helping out that old saint. And his personal faith and trust, that would be boosted even more. And his praise of God would be motivated even more. You know, sometimes we forget that when God takes us through difficult times in our lives, he's doing it for our own good. It may be for the strengthening and developing of our personal faith. And we just need to keep on trusting him and keep on going to him in prayer as this mature believer did. And here's a challenge to us all. In those times of difficulty, or whatever time that we go through in life, what is it that ultimately motivates our prayers? Is it God's own glory and praise, like it was for the psalmist? When we ask things of God, do we ask with his glory and praise as our ultimate goal? And when he answers our prayer requests with a yes, does it motivate and increase our continual praise to him? It's a challenge for us all. When he proves himself faithful yet again in our lives, do we take that and do we remember it? And do we use it to just launch our praise of him with our mouths all day long? May we all seek first God's kingdom and glory and increase in our praise of him as he continues to prove himself faithful. And this leads to the final feature that I want to highlight this morning. The mature believer continually hopes in God and proclaims his praises. And we see this in verses 14 through 24. So we'll carry on reading. "But as for me, I will hope continually, and I will praise you yet more and more. My mouth shall tell of your righteousness and of your salvation all day long. for I do not know the sum of them. I will come with the mighty deeds of the Lord God. I will make mention of your righteousness, yours alone. O God, you have taught me from my youth, and I still declare your wondrous deeds. And even when I'm old and grey, O God, don't forsake me until I declare your strength to this generation, your power to all who are to come. For your righteousness, O God, reaches to the heavens, and you have done great things. O God, who is like you? You who have shown me many troubles and distresses will revive me again and will bring me up from the depths of the earth. May you increase my greatness and turn to comfort me. I will also praise you with a harp, even your truth, O my God. To you I will sing praises with the lyre, O Holy One of Israel. My lips will shout for joy when I sing praises to you, and my soul which you have redeemed. My tongue also will utter your righteousness all day long, for they are ashamed, for they are humiliated who seek my hurt. You know, despite what God does, the author here promises to hope in God continuously, to praise God increasingly, and to witness about God tirelessly. And if that isn't a portrait of a mature believer, I'm not sure what is. If we aim to emulate this believer's attitude in life, we'd all be doing pretty well. So application: hope in God continuously, praise God increasingly, and witness about God tirelessly. Again, the author thinks back on the faithfulness of God throughout his life, and that just sparks another outburst of praise. From his youth, he remembers that the lessons and the examples that God has taught him about God's faithfulness, about trusting in him, about his strength and his power and his wondrous deeds. And he commits to proclaiming the countless aspects and illustrations of God's righteousness and salvation. Even when he's old and gray, he calls for God to continue sustaining him so he can just continue to declare God's strength and power to the next generation and all who are to come after. You know, what passion and fervor for God's exaltation. Again, God's glory and God's praise is at the very center of his request. You know, what sincere believer wouldn't like to look like this guy as they run the race and fight the good fight? You know, most of us think, you know, at the end of our days, I want to start slowing down. I want life to get a bit easier. I want to kick back and relax a bit more. And I don't think that concept ever got into this guy's head. You know, he was at full sprint right to the very end, striving with all his might to that finish line. He's so passionate and zealous for God's glory because he truly knows his God. He knows his righteousness is immeasurable. It reaches to the very heavens, he says. He knows he is the God who does great and wondrous things. There is none other like him. He spent a lifetime getting to know God, a lifetime learning from him, and he knows that whatever happens in his current circumstance, the one who leads him through the trials and difficulties in life will revive him again. God will lift him up from the depths that he's fallen to and comfort and restore him. Such is his confidence in the faithfulness of God. He closes his prayer here with another commitment to bring God praise. Using harp and lyre, lips, mouth, tongue, and soul, he commits to praising God for his truth, his faithfulness, and righteousness. And the final phrase of his prayer I found really interesting. In verse 24, he finishes with, "My tongue will also utter your righteousness all day long, for they are ashamed. For they are humiliated who seek my hurt." I don't know if you noticed, but there's an interesting link with that word ashamed that runs right throughout the chapter. He began back in verse 1, declaring his trust in the Lord, asking him, "Let me never be ashamed of that trust." And then around the middle of the chapter in verse 13, he revealed the adversaries of his soul, which is an interesting description. The enemies who said that God has forsaken him, he asked God, let them be ashamed. and consumed, let them be covered with reproach and dishonor. And now here at the very end of his prayer in verse 24, he categorically affirms that they are already ashamed. You know, as far as you know, God hasn't acted on this prayer yet, but in his mind, they've already got what they deserve. They're as good as toast. They're done for. Such is the faith of the seasoned saint and his faithful God. He knows that God's faithful. It's as Hebrews 11 verse 1 says, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things unseen. He was 100% sure, 100% convinced that God would prove himself faithful. He knew his God. So by way of conclusion, a few loose end type thoughts that I'll just let linger. God's righteousness is something that we believers ought to always delight in. We should thank and praise God for it. We should speak to others about it. We should beware of how we constantly fall short of it. And we should fall upon Christ who imputes it to our account by his grace through faith. God's righteousness is something that should always motivate us to draw closer to him and to praise God even more. Those who fully trusted in God from their youth, they have a long history of God's faithfulness to draw on. As such, they should have a strong, robust faith and be people full of praise for God. See that example in this chapter. So our personal case of God's faithfulness illustrated in our lives is an irreplaceable wealth of encouragement to help us continue walking the path of faith. And it's a wellspring of motivation with which to praise and glorify God. So it's valuable. We need to be purposeful in remembering those many times throughout our lives that God's been faithful to us. And we need to cherish it and we need to praise God from that. God not only illustrates his faithfulness for our needs at the time, but also to bolster and grow our faith for what he has in store for us in the future. And to motivate praise and glory from us for what he has done. So there's always something else going on when we're going through tough times in our lives. God is using that for his glory, for his honor, and for our own good. As the years pass on our journey of faith, our personal faith should strengthen and our praise should increase as we see over and over and over again God's faithfulness in our lives. And if this isn't happening, well then something's very, very wrong. And something needs sorting out urgently. So perhaps it's time to take stock and to have a deep look at what's going on in your life if that's not happening for you. God's people know where their security and their strength is. It's in God. It's made available to us through the person and the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. Our strength and our security is in him, so we need to stay close to him, don't we? So how do we stay close to him? Well, through regular confession of sin, through Bible study, through prayer, through shared fellowship and worship, and willing obedience to his word. You know, like any relationship, our one with Almighty God takes effort, it takes time, it takes commitment. We need to spend time with him in prayer and meditation. We need to spend time fellowshipping and listening to what others have learned on their life's journey about the faithfulness of God. We need to study his revealed word of truth. You know, it contains what God wants you to know about him. There's no better way to learn more about God than by reading and studying and delving into scripture and meditating on it and saturating yourself in it and living in obedience to it, applying its truth to your life. You know, as believers, we ought to be rock dwellers, safely living continuously in the safety of God, our refuge. The author of Psalm 71 knew and acknowledged God's faithfulness from his youth. He had a long journey living for the one who is truly faithful and righteous. Now, he exampled, as Paul did, what it takes to give God your all, right to the very end. He ran the race. He fought the fight. And even though he's advanced in age, he pressed on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God. And what believer wouldn't want that as his goal? So a wonderful portrait here of an aged believer who is continuing strong in his faith and giving God glory for that. And we should all desire to emulate that attitude in our own lives as we continue that glory, continue that journey ourselves. So let's pray and ask that God helps us along our journey of faith so that we can glorify and bring him praise in our lives continuously. Yes, Lord, we do thank you for examples like this in Scripture, Lord, that we can just stop and take stock of. Lord, men who have acknowledged your faithfulness, acknowledged your righteousness, Lord, who have shown us their faith by, Lord, how they praise you, how they live. And Lord, we thank you that we can come to you and we can ask, Lord, that you help us in our faith's journey. Lord, that you bolster our faith, Lord, that you increase our praise, Lord, as you show yourself faithful over and over and over again in our lives. Father, we may not have men who are out to hurt us at this time, but Lord, we know that life is full of ups and downs, full of uncertainty. And Lord, it's chapters like this that just reassure us that you are faithful, that you are watching over us, and that you are our rock of refuge that we can dwell in continuously, Lord, because you are faithful, you are capable of help, you're capable of refuge, you're capable of mighty and wondrous deeds. Lord, help us to grow our faith, help us to increase our praise as we seek to live for you, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.